Okay, fine. Now, in the third unit, so whatever we have discussed till now, it is been based upon the two topics, where the first we have introduced the O-type tubes, or it is been also called as linear beam type tubes. Okay, is the alignment okay, Andy? Can you able to see with properly what I am writing over here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. And next we have M-type tubes, where it can also be called as crossed field type tubes. Okay, it is being called as linear beam type tubes, and it is being called as crossed field type of tubes. Where, why it is being called as linear? We have discussed that where the RF field, which is to be amplified, both AC and DC will be applied. Okay. So these two supplies should be linearly varied. Okay, these two supplies will be linearly varied within the tubes or within this particular components. Okay, it is in a tube, we can say. So such type of tubes in which we have the supplies, the RF voltage, the RF AC voltage, and the DC supply voltage, which will be varying linearly. Okay, so such type of tubes can be considered as O-type tubes. But coming to the crossed field type of tubes, so in this case, where the both the fields here, the both the supplies will be crossing each other. Okay, they'll be crossing each other, and we'll see how it has been crossing out while we discuss the topic of the N-type tubes. Okay, and now with this, we have expanded our discussion in the O-type tubes. It totally third unit. Okay, this is the main classification of tubes. The third unit, we have general classification of tubes, microwave tubes. And this basic classification, we have the third unit entirely about the O-type tubes. We have different types of tubes we have discussed. Those are resonant tubes, we can say. And here we can see that the first basic tube which we have discussed is of two cavity klystron amplifier. It is the first basic tube which we have discussed in case of O-type tubes. Okay, and the second one we have discussed about the reflex klystron. Reflex klystron. So these are the two tubes which come under the category of O-type tubes, which we have discussed in the third unit. So these two will be totally related to the third unit. And we have discussed related to the two cavity klystron amplifier. We have discussed all the operational functionality, all the construction we have discussed, the operation we have discussed, the working principle, everything we have discussed related to the two cavity. And similarly, we have discussed about the bunching process. We have discussed about the mathematical expression, the derivation of bunching process. We have discussed related to the two cavity, how the amplification has been taking place, what are the steps involved, and what are the dependent things, how it has been varying, everything we have derived. And today, once again, I'll be just briefing out about this, not this one. We have already done this before the mid examinations. And the third one, we have discussed about the output power. And after that, we have gone for efficiency. Okay, so these are the three points which we have discussed related to the two cavity before the mid exam. So this is before mid one. We have discussed this particular two cavity klystron amplifier. So this is then half of the part of the third unit. Similarly, the remaining half, which we are going to discuss, that is after mid exam. Okay, after mid we are going to discuss this. Okay, and that is nothing but a reflex klystron. It is another type of tube, and I'll be giving the differences where we have two cavities here, and whereas we have in case of reflex klystron we have a single cavity. And we have seen the working functionality of this reflex klystron, the construction we have seen. Here also, the reflex klystron, we have discussed about the functionality, the construction, the operational functionality, how it done. So, and what are the process it has been taking place for the bunching, it has been explained in its construction related to the reflex klystron. And after that, I have explained the bunching process, the mathematical expression, even in this case. The mathematically, with respect to the time periods T2 minus T1, the derivation has been discussed related to the reflex klystron. Now after that, we have the third point, the output power we have and the efficiency. So these are the topics which we have to discuss related to the reflex klystron. See how easy it is. So this is the half part. So this is the half part and this is another half. So this has been totally half of the third unit and this is half of the third unit. How simple it has been. Around four topics, if you are perfect with, there are four topics. The operational functionality of two cavity followed by this derivation and operational functionality of reflex piston followed by this derivation. So if you could able to learn it properly and work hard related to these two particular topics, it's been more than enough. You can easily score. However, the way they can ask the question, you can easily able to attempt that and you can score maximum in this. Okay, so that's what it can be done. So that I insist to please give more weightage for such topics which consumes less amount of time for the preparation and score maximum in whatever the way they ask. They may be asking either two cavity or reflex klystron. They don't have any other options or to ask it indirectly or something like that. Okay, they will be asking either two cavity or they may ask either reflex klystron. You can check in the night or what the question papers, whatever it has been the case, we'll be able to find the questions related to these two topics only. Okay, so that please concentrate. The second half of the microwave engineering has been very, very easy and takes a very short amount of time to cover the second half of the syllabus. Now you can see here. So within one or two classes, just by today, we are about to complete this particular third unit, because already we have discussed about the constructional features and the bunching process we have already discussed, and just I'll be recalling it. Okay. And the output power and efficiency has been very small derivation which can be processed by continuation of this bunching process. Okay. So how easy it has been to cover the third unit. And similarly, the fourth unit we have, okay, we'll be discussing in the afternoon related to the fourth unit. It is also very easy and very small. Only two topics as we have discussed here also in the fourth unit, we are about to discuss only two topics. That has been more than enough. And the questions which it has been coming out of this particular unit will be of either of these two topics only. Okay, so nothing more than that. So that, please concentrate and be regular to the classwork of all the subjects, because most of the subjects, they have very less syllabus compared to the first half. Okay. So that I inform you and suggest you to please be regular to the classwork. It's been more than enough so that the preparation, more than half of the preparation can be done just by attending the classes and concentrating on the topics, whatever it has been discussed in the class. Okay, just don't be login and move out. So that's my intention. Now, before proceeding to the efficiency, just I'll be giving out the just a brief discussion about the topic what we have discussed in the previous class. Then later on, I'll be continuing. Okay. Now, coming to the third unit, that is the derivation, so which has been already worked out. So don't think that it's enough a big derivation, as it has been seen that in the case of two cavity, you have worked out about the bunching process derivation, the mathematical expression. It is of similar way, and I'll be helping you how to remember the derivation, the steps involved in the reflex klystron, the bunching process of mathematical expressions. Okay, so for that, just briefing out, then I'll be moving to the next topic. By today, the third unit has been almost completed already. Okay, in the fourth unit, we'll start with a new topic today. So please join back even in the afternoon session also. So it has been very, very important. So remaining half of the microwave engineering being very important, so that I insist to please be regular. So coming to the derivation, you can see here, that's what we have used, the mathematical expression. Today, after completion, by today or tomorrow, I'll be sharing you the material related to this. The written material also, I'll be sharing it to you so that you can start preparing for the external examinations, so that will be easier for you. Okay. So that's what we have explained. there are only one cavity, there is only one cavity in case of reflex klystron, and where the cathode, after giving it a DC supply, starts emitting the electron beam. So if I am somewhat fast, please give a message in the chat box, no problem, because already we have discussed all these topics, so that I am moving a little bit faster. Okay, so even though you just let me just revise me or give an intimation for me, if I am fast or not able to understand any of the particular equation over there. Okay, so there is no problem that I'll be revising you. Okay, even whatever be the question, it is being asked by any corner of the student in the entire class, I am ready to clear out their doubt. Okay, but only that you should be perfect and you should learn the concept. Don't bad the things, you have to learn the concept. So that's what my intention. Where we have an anode cavity and we have a repeller, which is enough high negative potential over here. And the RF input which we apply through the cavity, it is been given as V1 sine omega t. Okay, so from this, with this approximation, we are going to derive an expression for different time in intervals. See here, whenever the electron beam is being influenced by the RF field over here, so what are the steps involved, I'll be explaining in this particular derivation. So this is actually the reflex klystron, whatever we have discussed in the previous class. So this is the interaction time. Okay, so this is what the RF input from the cavity and electron beam from the cathode will be interacting here. So these two will be linearly varied. So that's what it has been called as linear beam type tubes. So the variation of RF field and electron beam will be linear to each other. So this is the interaction gap we find. And same as whenever with this, after electron beam is being interacted with the RF field, the velocities of those electrons will be varying. So the time taken here, it has been considered as T1. T1 is the time taken to move the electron towards the repeller. So this is one of the time, and when it returns back, they form a bunch because of variation in their velocities, they form a bunch. And during the return time, the time taken, it is been considered as a time T2. And during this particular time period only, the bunches will be formed over here, and that is being taken out the output of through the RF output from this particular cavity. Okay, so that's what we are going to derive, the time interval where the bunching will be taking place, that is being T1 minus T2. Okay, that is now the time taken between these two is been T2 minus T1 is been taken out. So that is nothing but the derivation of the bunching process for the case of reflex klystron. Okay, so that's the intention to calculate. And here it has been at one of the case, if you could remember, we have used x equal to 0. The distance traveled by the electron is being considered to be 0, and we have substituted this particular condition. We have substituted time is equal to T1 at once during the forward journey of the electrons, and we have substituted T equal to T2 during the retarded, the reverse journey of the electrons. Okay, and at that particular instant, we have considered as x equal to 0. It's because the distance where it has been starting its journey over here, it has been moving through the repeller space and coming back, and once again with respect to this particular interaction gap, then the distance traveled by those electrons is being considered as it has been 0. It seems that the not at all the electrons has been moved from this particular gap. So this is how it is being considered as x equal to 0 at one of the instant. So this is the condition. So now let us proceed with the derivation, where after considering this particular diagram, where we have made use as the calculations to follow up to calculate the time intervals expression. And for that, we have used this particular expression from the two cavity klystron amplifier that we have got by equating potential energy and kinetic energy. So this is the equation which has been resulted by equating potential energy and kinetic energy. Okay, and by equating them, we have got that equation 1. Once we have got, we have expanded for our comfort to easy to analyze. it has been expanded in binomial expansion. So that is being taken as root 1 by 2 is being taken out. And during that, whenever RF input is being provided, the velocity of the electrons will be different. So that it is being taken as V1. Initially, it was V0. Now, the velocity will be different because RF supply is being given. So that velocity will be different. Velocity of the electrons will be different. So that it is being taken as another velocity as V1. And let this be equation 2. And the total voltage at this particular instant, it is being taken as Vr minus V0. Okay, so that's what it has been written here. The total voltage is being given as Vr minus V0. Now, during returning back, the electrons will influence by some electrostatic field over there. Then that is being given as E is equal to V by D. So this negative we are considering because the electrons are moving in the opposite direction. So that we have considered it as the negative sign. E is equal to V by D. Here it has been distance is nothing but S is the repeller space. And the voltage here is nothing but Vr minus V0. Then this particular electric field intensity, it has to be substituted in the equation of the force equation. I'll be letting you how there are two types of forces in which it is being affected. The reflex system is being affected. There are two types of forces in which it is being involved, where we know that F is equal to minus E into E is one of the force, and E is an electrostatic field. Just now we have seen. Then substituting the expression of electrostatic field in this equation, we'll get this negative, and the negative of this electrostatic field will become positive, where we have substituted the electrostatic field equation as Vr minus V0 by S. And the another way of expressing the force on the electrons in the tube, it is being given as F is equal to M into A, where A is the acceleration. It can be written as d square x by dt square. Now, under equilibrium condition, these two forces are equal. So that equating equation 4 and 5, we get this particular equation. See here, in this, the both the equations are compared. Okay, equating, we'll get the resultant expression of as shown in equation 6. Now, here the steps, I'll be explaining the steps here. As we have d square x, double differentiation, we have to integrate twice. So almost on 90%, as I have told previously, the derivation will be finished just by integrating twice. First, and substituting the constant value in the main respective equation. So then we'll get the total time interval, whatever we have, we are expecting. Here, where it is being taken as d square x by dt square, the, if we integrate once, we'll get with respect to t over here and some constant c, and we need to calculate that constant c and substituting in this equation, then so that is one of the equation we get, standard equation. After that, we'll get dx by dt here because we have already integrated once. The second time we have to differentiate, then we'll get only the distance x over here. Then we'll get some other constant as c1. Okay, then we have to calculate the value of C1 and substitute in the standard equation, we'll get one more equation. So those are the procedure to proceed to calculate the time intervals where the bunching is taking place. Now, first integrating that in equation 6, here we get dx by dt, and with respect to t we are doing plus some constant C. And I've told that initially we need to substitute t equal to t1 there. And here dx by dt is nothing but the velocity equation. So distance by time is nothing but the velocity. So that here it has been replaced by V1 plus E by ms Vr minus V0. T place in place of T, we get T1 plus constant C. And after that, after substituting, we'll get this particular equation. Then we have to calculate the value of C. All we need to take to the LHS and we'll get the value of C and substitute in equation 7. This value of C is being substituted in equation 7. Then the value, the equation which is been resulting as been given in shown in equation 8. So this is the first way. First we need to integrate once, and the constant C value to be calculated and substituted. After substituting, we get the resultant equation 8. And according to the procedure I have told, we need to integrate once again. So after integrating once again, we'll get this as x, and this is nothing but t value. We get t square by 2, and that 2 it is being taken over here, and it's been t square is being written over here. That is v1 of t here plus some other constant we get as c1. And once again, we need to calculate the value of c1 and substitute in equation 9. For that, as I've told that, we need to apply then a condition as x equal to 0, where I have explained, and t is equal to t2 we need to consider. And for that, after substituting these condition in equation 9, we'll get the value of 0, and so that it has been easy to find the value of c1. Once the value of c1 is being found, then we need to substitute in equation 9. So after substituting, we'll get the equation, the final equation of t2 minus t1 over here. And that is the final expression. So that it is being obtained as been shown in equation at this particular equation. So this is the final equation which we get after substituting the value of c1. Now to get a standardized expression, we want t2 minus t1. So that taking this particular term to RHS, then it becomes plus v1 t2 minus t1. This t2 minus t1 and t2 minus t1, one whatever we have, it gets cancelled. The leftover term will be of t2 minus t1. So taking all these two RHS, we get the equation 10. So this is what we get, the equation 10 over here. Okay. Then here, the v1 we have. So this v1 value we need to substitute. So before substituting the value of v1, so it is been either converted into the same, it is been placed either t2 minus t1 of no problem. It may be involved to standardize an angular velocity or angular frequency is being involved over here, but multiplying on both the sides with omega, that is an angular frequency, to get in a standardized equation. Okay, then once after multiplying, we need to substitute the value of v1, as I have told in equation 2 only. So where the equation 2, I have told you that this is the equation 2. So this is the equation 2, the value of v1, which is to be substituted in the equation, final equation 10 over there. Okay. So here we need to substitute the value of V1. So that is the final expression which we get, and that is being given by this particular expression. Okay. So that is how omega T2, and we have taken to RHS as omega T1 and theta naught dash. So where theta naught dash, we have assumed that one of the expression here, where it has been somewhat complex to write over here, where so that it has been approximated, this particular expression has been approximated to theta naught dash. Okay, so substituting the value of theta naught dash, then we get this is the final expression. So omega t2 plus omega t1, so theta naught dash is a transit angle, and this has been as it is, which is been influenced by RF field. So this is how the final expression which we have derived related to the time constraints while the bunching is been taking place. Okay, so I request you, once the material is been, the notes has been shared to you, please go through the derivation and follow that, practice on paper, don't read it, just practice on paper, then you will get, definitely will get in a perfection on that. And if you have any doubt, you can approach me. Okay. So for that, you need to practice twice or thrice, because these two derivations are very important, and definitely it will be asked for the 10 marks. Okay. So the derivation in case of two cavity, derivation in case of reflex crystron. So those four topics, as I've told, the working functionality followed by derivation, reflex crystron working functionality followed by derivation. So these four questions are very, very important. Okay. So that's what I insist to go through with these four topics in the entire third unit. Then you can easily answer the question, whatever it is being asked, and the questions will be expected from these four topics only. Okay. Next, we'll proceed the discussion related to the efficiency of reflex crystron. So for that, we need to calculate the output power, where efficiency is nothing but the ratio of output power to the input power. Okay, so output power which is being delivered and the input power which is being given. Okay, so that's what we need to get initially to get the efficiency expression. To calculate the output power, where the DC input power which is being given as P DC is equal to V0 into I0, So let this be equation one. And this has been already derived. Please do remember this particular expression. So output power delivered, that is PAC, will be equal to I naught V2 J1 of X. This is nothing but the bunching parameter. J1 of X dash is the bunching parameter and sine theta naught dash, the RF input which has been involved here. Now, we'll get maximum efficiency whenever we substitute these values of maximum. Okay, whenever we substitute the maximum values in the RHS terms, then we'll get the maximum output. When we take the ratio of these two, output by input, then efficiency will be also maximum. Okay, so our intention is to get the maximum efficiency of reflex klystron. So for that, we need to substitute the constraints of the maximum values. And for that, from the graph, as I have shown previously in the textbook, where there are so many graphs as the logarithmic value, we have the tabular form and the graphs. From that, we need to take. So there is no separate derivation to remember that. So for that, I insist you, please practice to remember the values of this X and J1 of X. And here it has been taken as the sine theta will be maximum. That will be having the one is the maximum value of sine theta naught. So that we need to substitute as one to get the maximum output power delivered. And where V2 is enough output voltage, and that will be equal to V0. So by substituting these conditions, we can calculate the output power delivered. And for that, where here I naught, once after substituting the maximum values as sin theta naught equal to 1 and V2 as V1, this is the equation which has been resulted. And here X dash, it has been taken as V1 by 2 V0 theta naught dash, which has been taken from the equation over here. So this is nothing but related to the value of X dash, okay, from the equation of bunching parameter. And that was the same taken, X dash equal to V1 by 2 V0 theta naught dash. So from this, we can calculate the value of V1. So V1 can be calculated as taken these two RHS divided by theta naught dash. Okay, the same I have written over here. That's what it has been written. So now, after doing that, we get here V0, that is 2 V0 to X dash by theta naught dash. So theta naught dash is nothing but 2 n pi minus pi by 2, where it has been given as theta naught dash is equal to 2 n pi by minus pi by 2. Just it has been substituted. So then we'll get this particular equation. Then V0 will be equal to V0, we can take it to RHS. Now once V0, V1 value is being recorded, so we need to substitute the value over here. Okay, so where it has been substituting the V1 value in PA0, PAC. So PAC can be substituted, the value of V1, V2. So this V1 value is being substituted here. Whatever we got the V1 here by taking to RHS and substituting theta naught dash, we get the value of V1, and we have to substitute in this output power delivered. So this is the final expression of output power delivered. Up to this extent, you need to work out. Okay. Once it has been derived, the equation three, this is the final equation, the output power obtained in case of reflex klystron. Now it has been easy to derive the expression of efficiency. Okay. So this efficiency has been given as output power delivered by the tube, that is reflex klystron tube, by the input power which has been applied. Okay, so substituting PAC value here, and PDC is nothing but V0 into I0. So this V0, V0, I0, I0 will be cancelled out. The left out term will be of with this expression shown in equation 4. Now, here maximum efficiency has been our requirement. So for that, we need to substitute the maximum values of bunching parameters. For that, I have told you that the bunching is been taking place for every 1 3/4 cycle. Instead, we can round it off to a nearest whole number, so that for every 1 3/4 cycle, the bunching is been taking place. So that have made use to the nearest whole number as taking it as n equal to 2. So in place of n, we need to substitute 2 over here. And to get the maximum values, the X value which is being taken to reach this particular expression of the maximum value, it is being taken as 1.252 is the maximum value of this particular bunching parameter. So we'll get 1.252 whenever we substitute as X dash as 2.402. Then once after substituting this value as 2.408, the bunching function of this will be recorded as 0.52. J1 of x to be substituted as 0.52 and x dash to be taken as 2.408. When we take the product of these two, we get 1.252. Okay, so that is the final expression which is being given. After substituting and simplifying, we'll get the efficiency as 22.78%. So this is the theoretical efficiency which has been resulting. So within a minute, the meeting is going to end. So please rejoin back so that we'll compare the reflex crystron and two cavity. What are the performance characteristics? Then in the afternoon class, we'll be proceeding with the fourth unit. Okay. So if you have any doubt in this particular derivation, from whatever the initial of the class have taken it,